live from the beautiful sun-kissed island of Kauai, it's Animal Talking. Tonight, join Gary and his guests, Shaggy, Jimmy O. Yang, Jordan Vogt Roberts, and Kiki Wolfkill. And now, because somebody's got to do it, here's your host, Gary Whitta.
Oh, yes, indeed. Thank you, thank you, thank you, everyone. It's Animal Talking. It's summertime. And what better way to kick off the summer than with a little Shaggy?
What a piece of dilemma. Demonic seed supply. Girls from near and far I request me banana. Me a the gal them banana farmer. The whole of them I request me banana.
Till I come and then I want go home.
Give them me one time, two time, them want more.
Till I come and then I want go home.
Give them me three times, sometime, them want four.
Till I come and then I want go home.
Me have a Latina girl, she named Cassandra. She tell me say she come straight from Colombia. So I'm here to recommend my banana. Tranquila mama, see it as the manana. That's how we do it. That's how we do it, so we do it, so we do it. Y'all tell me, say me banana sweet. They say the length and the side make them weak.
Shaggy, thank you so much for joining us on Animal Talking. What a treat it is to have you here.
Man, you have an amazing staff, by the way. Your crew is on point. They're, you know, it's funny how they know everything about the screen without, you know, even looking at it. That's amazing.
You see, now that's just going to go to their heads. You've done me no favors there at all, frankly. They're going to be impossible to deal with. I do have to give special credit to my wife, Leah, my executive producer also. And she actually makes the avatars on the show when people need us to do that for them. All credit. I think she's done a wonderful job on your avatar. You told me in the pre-interview that your wife actually prefers this version of you to the real thing.
Yeah, she says it's cuter.
This is why I like being in this game. I have hair. I'm handsome. I'm like completely the opposite as I am in real life. You're sitting here on the couch here in the beautiful sun-kissed island of Kauai. But in reality, you actually are on your own beautiful sun-kissed island right now. You are joining us live from Kingston, Jamaica.
Live from Kingston, Jamaica, man.
Oh, my God. Is that like your spiritual home?
It is my main home. It's where my wife, kids, and dogs are. And less COVID.
How is it going over there? Is everyone wearing masks? Are people being sensible? Like, what's that whole situation?
Everybody's really, really social distancing, and they're wearing their masks. It's mandatory that anywhere in public you do wear a mask. And on top of that, you know, they jumped ahead of the curve really quick, and they quarantined everyone, set proper curfews, closed businesses. And, you know, they did the whole thing, and I'm very, very proud of them. I've been here 2 weeks, and I'm, you know, my 2 week quarantine is up now, but they did an amazing job, and I feel a lot safer walking around if I was in Florida, for instance.
Why do you think I do this talk show? I'm not leaving my basement.
Yeah, I know, right?
I got to talk to you about this stone cold banger that you opened the show with, Banana. 20 billion with a B views on TikTok, and it's even sparked something called the Banana Drop Challenge. 26.7 million TikTok videos have been created off the back of that song. Tell me about the Banana Drop Challenge.
You know, it's some guys from New Zealand, man. They literally came up with this whole dance. And it just went viral.
Banana breaking news. This just came in like 5 minutes before we went live. That song is now number one on radio in Mexico. And you beat Lady Gaga to take the number one spot. What the hell?
I know, right? And what's so great is, you know, it's that we're doing this, you know, at the almost 30 years of career. And I'm still here with a whole new generation of young kids and on such an amazing new platform. You know, I'm just very, very, very fortunate and just, you know, just a lot of gratitude.
It was pointed out to me during the research for this that you have now had big, major, like number one hits in four consecutive decades, which is, I mean, you know, so you're no one hit wonder. I mean, you know, like Kate, our stage manager, was just fangirling over you and it wasn't me. You know, she grew up with that song.
I'm the most consistent one hit wonder.
just one hit wonder after another. What is the secret to making a song that goes viral and just stays in the public imagination like that?
I couldn't tell you what makes it go viral because this is all new to me. But I could tell you, as far as me making songs, I try to go against the grain. I try not to do cookie cutting. I don't like the status quo. I'm always a guy as all. And so that makes it a little harder for me because record companies, they really like cookie cutting, you know, they want to, you know, and radio likes that too. So when you come with something that is totally different, they tend to not want to play it. But I, for some reason, you know, write these records that are become infectious and just kind of just roll. And I've done it many times. And with this one, big up to Conqueror, who came with this amazing, did these lyrics and took the original melody from the Banana Boat song. And I heard and I thought it was just amazing.
I was going to say, like, when you're standing on the shoulders of Harry Belafonte, you're halfway home already, right?
Yeah, my brother, it's a proven record already, you know. But, you know, he did an amazing job, you know, converting those lyrics and making them so cheeky, and I really love that about it. So
you have this new album coming out, Hot Shot 2020, which is the 20th anniversary of the original Hot Shot. I'm going to put a little picture up here on the screen. Here's the new version, Hot Shot 2020. So you're re-recording some of your biggest hits, It Wasn't Me, Angel, Oh Carolina, Mr. Boombastic. What's it been like going back? And oh my God, did we just lose someone? I'm just going to let people look at your album cover for a bit longer here as we figure out who the hell just kicked us all off the set. Adam, how many different like safety procedures do I put in place to prevent this from happening?
At least one.
Welcome to technology.
Every bloody time, Adam. Who was it? Who dropped?
Well, I can tell you what, it wasn't me.
Oh, it was all worth it for that. It was all worth it. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God. Okay, well now we have to keep the whole thing in. That's, you know what, that is so, and Shaggy, my goodness, my hat's off to you, sir. That was so good. People are going to accuse us of staging the whole thing just to get to that line. That was incredible.
Next time you see Sting, anything you do, is one thing a lot of people don't know. He loves crossword puzzles.
Okay.
Right? A lot of people don't know that. And his favorite dessert is vanilla ice cream.
These are all great. By the way, I love the way that you say next time you see Sting, like that's ever going to happen. I mean, it's very optimistic. I do appreciate that. Okay, crossword puzzles. But next time I see him, yeah, crossword puzzles and ice cream. Okay, that's the way to Sting's heart. He said that you guys have now formed such a bond and have become such close friends that your wives are starting to get a bit worried about the two of you.
You know, the biggest thing I got out of that album, 44876, we won a Grammy, we sold well, we toured well, but I gained a friendship.
Hot Shot 2020 is the album. That's coming out July 10th. All of Shaggy's greatest hits remastered, reapproached for a whole new generation. Shaggy, thank you so much for joining us on the show. You've been a really great guest. Thank you for bringing your music.
Oh, thank you, Gary, man. All the best, man.
I got to give you credit for that, busting out that it wasn't me. Like the whole technical screw up was worth it for that alone. Like that teed you up so perfectly. Thank you so much.
Man, access to your villa. Trust us, and I'll get all reaction on your pillar.
Oh, amazing.
Oh, my God. What a treat. What a treat. Shaggy, you are welcome back here anytime, sir. Thank you so much.
To
here.
It would be so tough to follow such an amazing comedian with such an incredible joke.
Yes.
How could you ever follow that?
I mean, I the only way we could do that, I guess, is if we were to have like a professional comedian coming on next. Fortunately, that's exactly what we have. My next guest is a super duper talented actor, stand-up comedian. Please welcome to the show. I'm so glad to have him. He's such a great guest. Jimmy O Yang. Take a seat on the couch.
Has anybody done that move though? I mean, come on.
Not with the rose in the mouth like that. Let's get the elephant in the room out of the way. That was you who dropped Connection, right?
I think so, but it was I want to blame a producer and
yeah, that's what I do. That's always a good way to go.
But it doesn't matter because we got Shaggy to say it wasn't me. So I think I was actually being a really good guest.
Well, so are you gonna make the excuse here that your comedic genius was to engineer a scenario that would tee Shaggy up to make that joke?
Well, me and my best friend Shaggy worked that whole thing out. So. I didn't even know what stand-up comedy was growing up because that wasn't a big thing in Hong Kong yet. And I remember the first stand-up comedy I saw was BET Comic View on BET when I was about 13, 14 years old, when I first came to America. And it was just like such a fresh art form. And it wasn't just funny. It was like informing me about culture and everything that's, you know, within America. Right when I was about to graduate college with an economics degree, I knew I wasn't about to be like in finance. I just hated every bit of that. So it was a desperation that kind of drove me to stand-up comedy. Googling local open mics is one step away from Googling what's the best way to kill myself. So I just got signed up to all the LACasting.com actors access, you know, and I just put my headshots up there and I just wrote new in town, need an agent, which in hindsight is exactly how you get preyed on. So I wanted like three different very small agents like hit me up. They're like, come meet with us. You know, and I was just an innocent 21, 22 year old kid. Who knows what could have happened? And my first meeting with an agency was with a commercial agency. And I went to Santa Monica. I drove all the way to Santa Monica. And the address was an apartment building, just like a 50 unit apartment complex. I was like, oh, dude, this is not right. And then I walked in. There was a sign up sheet in the lobby. And then some lady ushered me into the audition. And the audition was in the apartment rental office. Like the agent just rented a room from the apartment rental office and he had me read some signs from a Staples commercial. And apparently I was so bad that apartment rental agency agent never called me back.
I can't tell you how many times my wife and I have watched those clips of you prank calling Ehrlich. Oh my God.
That's one of those things that the table read, I read it. I'm like, there's no way this is going to work. Like, this is ridiculous. But then when I read it at the table read, everybody was dying laughing. And then when we did it, like, it was hard for me to keep a straight face. So I was like, okay, that was something there, you know? So yeah, it turned out to be one of the more memorable moments of Jing Yang.
What's the name of your stand-up special on Amazon?
Yeah, my special, it's called Good Deal, and it's on Amazon Prime.
Did you feel like mm-hmm. there was a moment where you suddenly blew up and you were like, I don't need to drive Ubers anymore? Like, was there like a tipping point moment where you felt like you had made it or broken through to the other side?
Well, when they made me a series regular in season two, money-wise, that was like an I made a moment. I wasn't getting paid a lot, but I was getting paid more than $900 an episode. So I didn't have to drive Uber anymore. I could go get my own apartment. So that was a huge moment. And Crazy Rich Asians was a big moment where, not even just for my career. Yeah, of course it helped my career, but it was a huge watershed moment, I think, for the Asian community. So I think ever since then, Asian actors, Asian creators, Asian writers has gotten a lot more opportunities because that movie proved that, you know, we could be front and center. We could carry a whole movie and, we do have a diverse group of talent, you know, in front of the scene and behind the scenes. Because usually when you're an Asian actor, you almost always the only Asian dude or girl on set. But with Crazy Rich Asians, I really felt like I found my creed. Because we all came from different backgrounds. We all had parents that wished that we were doing finance, lawyer, doctor. So we all went through that struggle. But, you know, we all kind of made it to some point. And those guys, all of those guys, they're still some of my best friends. And I really felt like I found my creed.
And now I got to talk to you, of course, about Space Force, because that's where we can currently find you on Netflix.
Yeah, so I play Dr. Chan Kai-Fung on the show. And he's also an immigrant, doesn't have an accent, but he's a scientist. So he's definitely something more honorable, someone more honorable than Jing Yang. He is John Malkovich's right-hand man.
When you first walk onto the set with John Malkovich, I know you're a professional, obviously, but like you've got to be nerding out a little bit.
Not just nerding out, man, but just like nervous. Like, oh my God, that is John Malkovich, dude. Like, and Steve Carell, man. I mean, and my first day shooting was a scene with those two.
Oh my
but
God.
But the thing is,
I wonder if they do that deliberately just to throw you in at the deep end.
I know, right? But they were the nicest people on the planet. And Steve literally like is the nicest guy in Hollywood, I think. And John is just a cool dude. Like he actually is very young at heart and he knows more about K-pop than I do. And he's just so open-minded. So there's something really cool hanging out with those two.
So you tell me, first of all, do you know this show One Punch Man?
Yeah, love.
Oh my God, that show is nuts in the best way.
Yeah. It's so awesome. Yeah, he's depressed because he's so good.
I love it.
I didn't even call it anime. To us, that was just cartoons. There was no difference between Dragon Ball Z and, you know, Tom and Jerry. That was just a cartoon. It's funny that Americans, it's a subcategory of anime because that seems a little more exotic. like it's walking a fine line between being, am I Chinese or am I American? Because the Chinese culture is you listen to your family, you know, whatever your dad says, your mom says, that is the go, and they reward that. Whereas American culture is they reward independence. If you go rebellious, you become an actor, you become a stand-up, and you become a rock star. So it's two very different conflicting thoughts. And I came here in such a formative year when I was 13 years old. So it was always just kind of tearing me both ways. So I thought, oh man, if I just share this story, honestly, I think that hopefully it will be an audience out there. Whereas it's other Asian kids, other immigrants, or just people that felt like they haven't fit in their life could find this relatable. And luckily the book did pretty well. It wasn't a New York Times bestseller or anything, but people that has read it has resonated with it a lot. And I pull some of the stories from the book into my stand-up special later on. And at the same time, you know, I'm trying to make that into a meaningful TV show. So we'll see. Back in Hong Kong, you could hack into a PlayStation 1 where you can play like the bootleg copy discs. So that's what we did. And we had every single game on the planet, man. And a lot of sports games, you know, we got real competitive with it. And also on the computer, me and a lot of my relatives and my brother started playing Heroes of Might and Magic, which is like the most nerdy game. It's a turn-based
Very
game.
Nerdy.
Yeah, I still love it. And, you know, we started playing Age of Empire, all of those, like, you know, that Red Alert, right?
I loved Red Alert. Those but Tesla those coils. Games,
yeah. Oh my God. That was how I was introduced to Tesla, way before Elon Musk.
What do you want to do with your career? Do you want to lean into acting? Do you want to lean more into stand up, or do you want to try and balance the two? Like, what are your long term? What's your long term ambition?
I want to do it all, baby. you know, I think stand up is really fun, and that's always my first love. I would love to do it, but like I said, it's just so time consuming, and I don't want to just dabble. If I'm gonna do it, I'm gonna give you a fucking great special, you know. So it'll be great if, like, say 4 months of the year I focus on that, and then I go shoot a couple movies. And if I can, you know, my off time, develop, produce, write some stuff, and also eventually down the line direct some things. Every job is exciting. I don't care if you work at McDonald's. The first 2 months working at McDonald's, it's exciting because everything's new. You're meeting new people. You're learning. You're growing. That's what's exciting about it, right? But then it gets stale. And the great thing about, you know, being in the entertainment industry is there's just so many different lanes. Every movie that I write or play is a different adventure. Every set that I do is a little different. And then from, you know, stand up to acting to writing to maybe even producing, directing, that's once again another direction. So if I can kind of switch between a few of these things that I truly all love, I think that'll be just very exciting if they keep letting me do all this.
Nice to see you again, Danny. I see you've been fishing.
I got a whole pocket full of stinky fish. More butterflies.
Oh my
God. There was another butterfly. Ice cream cone hat. Hi, Gloria. She has very nice eyelashes.
You're not wrong.
I like the way I run. You have to admit, I am very cute.
2020's weird, man. But like in the best way. Please welcome to Animal Talking, Jordan Vogt Roberts.
Wait, I went into the kitchen.
Oh my God.
Oh, did he go in the kitchen? I'm no longer clapping.
Someone needs to direct me. Which stairs do I go
to?
Oh
my God. Adam, go get him, please.
Well, your kitchen was beautiful. I needed a snack.
You know,
sorry
No, seriously though, you are now joined like a great pantheon of guests who have totally blown their cues and either walk down the stairs too early or walk down the wrong stairs or what the hell ever. Trust me, you're not the first and you won't be the last.
Thank you. Well, I'm glad I'm in a group of people who equally fuck up.
Your interesting look you've got going.
Well, it's very difficult to represent my giant 2-foot-long beard. So I just got this mustache or this beard thing. But before that, I had to, like, paint on like a pattern onto my face, which just like gave me these spikes on the side where I looked right. like shitty Wolverine. Pokemon was a huge influence to me. Like Blue and Red, you know, came out around the same time as like Metal Gear and Ocarina of Time, you know, like 96, 97, like those years had such influential things. And I just love the energy and the vibe of Pokemon so much.
Were you blue or red?
Blue, all day. Squirtle.
Oh, 100%. Yeah. Blue right. represent.
Someone asked what my favorite Pokemon is. I mean, Gengar's pretty high up there. I still, like, Squirtle is, like, one of my favorite things ever.
Yeah.
I also, this is a really weird one, but Zatu is one of my favorite characters who people wow. really dislike, but his lore of how he can like simultaneously like see into the future and the past and is sort of like paralyzed by it and doesn't move, I think is like one of the strangest, most interesting. Like there's so many Pokemon that have these really interesting pieces of backstory, even like Cubone, who like wears, you know, hypothetically its mother's skull, which is such a sad, interesting like story to for like and evolution and growth. And I love those elements of the Pokemon world.
What I love about you, Jordan, and it's obvious just hearing you talk right now, is that like your nerddom is 100% authentic.
Honestly, if I was smarter back in the day, like if I was good at math, I probably would have went into video games. Like I like film and video games were my like two loves, and I really like, I love film. I was obsessed with it. I devoured it. I'm a slave to it in so many ways. But like, you know, Journey for, you know, the PS3, when I played that, that was something where I was like, this is one of my favorite experiences in any medium. And there's just things happening in video games that I find to be so disruptive. The Sega Nintendo rivalry is so interesting to me because that was the start of like arbitrary division, you know, like Gamergate, you know, like people didn't lose friends over Coke versus Pepsi, right?
Right.
Like that was a giant thing of, oh, is it Coke versus Pepsi, whatever. But you didn't lose friends because somebody liked Pepsi over Coke. But back in that day, the way they weaponized technology, like if you had a Genesis or a Nintendo, that said something about you and you judged the other person. I think it weaponized like the way we look at technology now, like, oh, you've got an Apple or you've got a Samsung, you know, like the arbitrary things that somehow like these say something about you, and you then judge people based on it. And I think that like, you know, internet trolls and the way that like people like find these arbitrary things to stick to really stems from like those console wars in the 90s.
Just recently, you were quite famously in Death Stranding, and here you are right here in holographic form.
Well, that photo that you just showed, by the way, is the actual photo of Kojima-san holding his iPad showing me for the first time.
Don't worry, I got that too. Here we go. Here we go. I got it for you.
Metal Gear is one of the most important. I've been on that movie for 6 years, and I've been fighting every single day to make sure that we translate that movie properly, because I am so fortunate that I was able to take this path into film, and then through a lot of like launch campaigns for video game commercials and in general, like sort of interweave myself in the game world. I feel very fortunate to be able to have a foot in both realms. But with Kojima-san, you know, Metal Gear was one of those games that shaped, you know, that was like a Star Wars-esque experience for me. And, you know, so we initially went, like, I was at a meeting at Sony, and there was a Metal Gear book on the desk, and they were trying to pitch me a bunch of other movies, and I was like, do you have Metal Gear Solid? And they literally were like, yeah, but that's not for you. And I was like, I disagree. I am going to prove to you that there's not a single person in Hollywood who understands this property, the like military surrealism, the Japanese goofiness, the like walking, talking ideologies and like, you know, philosophies that the characters represent, the like the almost survival horror element, the like the Tarkovsky influence. And so I put together this massive book breaking down like what Metal Gear is, how you translate it into a movie. And it took a year, and they hired me on it, and it was 6 years ago. And I met Kojima-san like a while ago, and he was obviously kind of like, who is this kid? So we met, and we sort of had like a very from afar relationship. We would go back and forth. We'd see each other at Comic-Con here and there. And then when Kong came out, he really loved it. And he actually, when Kings of Summer was then released in Japan, he wrote liner notes for the DVD release, and in it he was like, you know, because then we had gotten to know each other so well, we had so many talks and so many dinners and so many back and forths about film, and he really is like, he's a bigger cinephile than most people in Hollywood, and it's surreal for me because he's a legend to me, right? He's a legitimate icon, and so I have these conversations with him where I'm talking to someone who's now my friend, but at the same time I'm like, you influenced my entire life, you shape huge parts of my creative process.
I'm going to put some of this amazing concept art that you sent. Let's go over here. I mean, some of this art is just incredible. How do you take something that is so idiosyncratic and so Kojima and somehow find a way to convince a Hollywood studio to, what's going to obviously be a huge amount of money, to make something that is palatable to, like, you know, the kind of the mainstream, you know, global audience that they want to get to?
Well, I mean, first, this art that you're going through, this is all stuff that I commissioned myself, and you know, Industrial Light and Magic, ILM, they stepped in to do this, but this is a lot of artists that I worked with on Kong, because when I worked on Kong, I specifically hired a lot of video game artists who had never worked in film before, because I felt like a lot of film concept artists were very, you know, it's the same shit, and I wanted people who had, like, that spark and that young creativity. I'm really, really proud of the script that we have, because we're doing, I mean, first of all, Kojima-san said to me, when I asked him, do you have any advice for me, he said this, and this is such a Kojima-san thing, he said, betray your audience. And I was like, okay, well, I'm not exactly gonna do that. We're doing something very cool and unexpected with the script that I think is, like, very in line with, like, the way that Metal Gear itself fucks with the format of video games. We're doing something that, like, fucks with the format of what you would expect from a film.
But it's a miracle to get anything made in Hollywood, especially something as big and expensive as this. Where are you with it right now? You've obviously been working on it for a long time. You say you have a script, you have this amazing concept art. What, at this point, what chance do you give yourself that you're actually going to be one day standing on a set shooting this movie?
Oh, God, I hate this question. look, this is my baby. I've been working on this thing for 6 years, trying to make it so it is the, like, disruptive punk rock, like true to Metal Gear, true to Kojima-san spirit version of what this is. And I will continue to fight for it every day until I can't. My left hand got, like, really horribly burned. I was involved in, like, an accident a couple of years ago, and, like, I had crazy skin grafts on it. And so the middle of it is, like, a graphic representation of the tools inside of Luke's arm in Star Wars. So it's like,
oh, wow. It's like Easter eggs inside Easter eggs in this tattoo.
It's very layered. I'm really proud of the fact that, like, on commercials like that or the Destiny one, when you look at the comments, it's a lot of people being like, that's how I feel when I play this game.
Know that you and my next guest are pals. So let's get you on the couch together. TV show, live action TV show coming down the pike. That's wait, get Kiki back up the stairs, please.
Kiki, go back to the kitchen.
I'm trying.
So we've had Jimmy drop his connection. We've had Jordan wandering into the kitchen, and now we've got Kiki coming down the stairs too early. Oh my God, poor Kate, poor stage manager Kate.
I'm sorry.
And recently was named one of the top 10 worst people at walking downstairs at the correct time. Please welcome to Animal Talking, my good friend Kiki Wolfgang.
Amazing to be here, and you know, I'm kind of bringing up the rear here. It's been an amazing show. So,
top of the bill, saving the best for last. How did you two become pals?
We met in a karaoke room, and then I think we had, like, Korean barbecue afterwards. Is that right?
Yeah. Anyone who remains friends with me after witnessing me at karaoke, it runs deep. So Living on a Prayer is my go-to.
Oh, I love it.
I just have to get to that chorus, and then the crowd does the rest of the work.
Johnny went to work on the dock. I can do it. I can do it too. I mean, not very well, apparently, but I can. I'll belt it out. My 7-year-old daughter just wandered into the Animal Talking studio over here. She's turning 8 tomorrow. She's gonna be 8 now.
Aww, go happy back birthday. To bed.
Get out of here, you little monkey.
I love playing games because I was sort of an avid reader, a huge consumer of games and books and movies. Really, really into the experience of escaping into another world. Definitely gravitated towards storytelling and visual storytelling in particular. I was an art minor. Strangely, I was a Chinese history major. But I left college wanting to make documentary films. Like, for me, expressing culture and history and a historical perspective through visuals was something I was really intrigued by. honestly really fell into games and started working on cinematics and doing compositing work for game cinematics, which is how I fell into it. And once I did, I was captivated. I loved the creative challenge of trying to tell a story with so, at the time, very few pixels on screen. The possibilities around narrative and storytelling with games when you're really invested and have a sense of agency really is what captivated me about games.
Real quick, just to reiterate, Kiki truly is such a badass. Like, one of the people who, like, every time I talk to her, every time I interact with her, you know, I come away inspired in some other way. The way that she thinks and the way that she just described her path through all of this, she's one of the most unique minds in the industry. And I mean, the fact that she's willing to, like, accept my weirdo ass is testament in itself. But she is just one of the biggest badasses in the entire industry.
So when Xbox launched, I was the art director for Project Gotham Racing, working with Bizarre Creations. And, you know, racing was part of my personal life, but I worked on a lot of racing games and then really started to move into broader genres, worked on Mass Effect, on Gears, on Crackdown, on Fable. In 2008, the opportunity as 343 was starting up. I got the opportunity to join 343, not as an art director, but as an executive producer. I was super excited. I was a huge Halo fan, like huge, huge Halo fan. You know, either this is going to be, you know, a really great achievement, or, you know, I'll go down in a giant ball of fire, and that, you know, that's a great trade-off, right?
That's when the best shit happens, though.
Exactly. If you're not a little bit scared all the time, and sometimes sort of bedwettingly scared, you know, you're not being ambitious enough.
I had the moment where I really felt like I was fucking up Kong, and I've called Phil from Lord & Miller. Called him, and I literally said, I think I'm fucking this up, man. And he said to me, if you didn't feel that way, it would be a problem. The fact that you feel that way means you care. And if you didn't feel that way, like, sure, maybe you get to a point where you have such, like, you know, such a fine line between, like, Kanye level confidence where you're also executing, but you're out of your mind. But if you're not a little bit scared, then you're not pushing yourself. Oh yeah. Anytime someone comes back and they shot a movie and I'm like, how'd it go? And they were like, it was awesome. It went great. I'm like, that movie's going to suck.
So Kiki, you are now, you have risen to this role, head of transmedia, which means, and you said, it's Halo's very, very story centric, or the massive mythology, all this storytelling that takes place inside the games. But you're now in charge of building that outside of the games. And like the big project right now is the big live action TV show that you're developing at Showtime. And I know that you're well into production on that. I know there's very little you can tell us, but tell us what you can about the Halo TV show. And
the biggest thing we're doing right now is Halo Infinite, which I wish I could talk more about, but I will say there is an extraordinarily talented team who is busting ass right now on that. And it's incredibly exciting. It's funny because, you know, with that happening at the same time as the TV show, it's really an extraordinary time to be at 343. But yeah, we've been with Showtime on this, and you know, we went through a period of really trying to figure out the right creative combination, and also figuring out what it meant for Showtime and Halo to come together. So they've been amazing partners in sort of like acknowledging and understanding and working to really collaborate on understanding those differences and figuring out what is the right adaptation for Halo. And I love to hear Jordan talking about the work that he does, because I think, you know, we look at it very much the same way, which is, you know, how do we take something and not try and verbatim translate it to a different medium, but how do we look at what the experience can mean for people?
You were for 8 years a professional race car driver.
It's true, but you know, I grew up around cars. My father raced cars. You know, as a kid, I was stuffed in the back of a 911, going to watch friends race at the racetrack. So it was kind of a really natural thing for me to be able to get into.
There was never going to be like Kiki Wolf kill photocopier repair person, right? Like, that was just never going to happen. You always had to do something super cool.
So that's a Noble M400. Amazing car. It was an English car. So, I'll stereotype a little bit and say I didn't expect it to make it for the whole event, but it did, and it was amazing. I have never driven with so little sleep and food and all of the things you're supposed to drive on the track with as that event, because you're literally driving like, you know, 600 miles, 800 miles in the middle of the night to get to the next track. It was awesome.
I'm gonna very politely ignore the little swipe you just took there at the British automotive industry.
Yeah, I know. And, but there's a part of you inside, Gary, that's like, yeah, I kind of get it.
I mean, when you step into a Lotus or an Aston Martin, are you worried that it's going to be a piece of shit?
No, you're right.
Here's a very cool glamour shot of you in what I'm not like a big car guy, but is this a Porsche that you're in right here?
It is.
This is one of my favorite headshots of you in the racing helmet. I love this one.
Oh, hell yeah.
I mean, there's no cooler headshot than that. And here's you, I think, with that same car in your racing.
That is the Noble. Yes, that is the Noble. The fantastic English car that I knew was going to kick ass from the very beginning. Don Panos, who did the American Le Mans series, had set up a women's only series way back when, which, you know, you always go into those things with mixed feelings because you don't feel like you should have to have a women's only anything. But on the flip side, it was really hard at the time for women to get opportunities to get into professional racing.
Here you are actually racing that Noble. What is the fastest you've ever gone in a car?
So I have to admit, the fastest I've ever gone in a car was as a passenger at Nürburgring, a 930 turbo roof Porsche. And we, as a passenger, I was there with an ex-Porsche Cup driver, and we got up to like, you know, 220 or something, literally ridiculous. The fastest I've driven or gotten on a straightaway, ironically, has not been on the track, because, you know, on a track, you're sort of limited by how long your straightaway is. And so I've gotten over 155 on the track, but up to 178 on the Autobahn.
I knew you were going to say the Autobahn. I love it. Who's this?
My brother. He raced as well. He was the editor-in-chief for Road and Track for a number of years.
Oh, wow.
I'm happy to have him back in Seattle. We drove a lot together, actually, because endurance racing was kind of my thing. And so he and I drove a lot together. We were actually a really strong team together. I was telling Jordan, I've stockpiled a ton of money, and I am like, have all these plans in my head for my island. I haven't done anything yet, but I have the means to do all that I want now.
I'm excited about this summer update, swimming in the ocean.
Yeah, right. That started today.
I think it's the day after tomorrow that it starts.
Oh, all I know is I found an unusual bug today that I had never seen before.
Oh, so. Yeah, because I think they rotate new bugs in and out every month. But I think July 3rd is when they're dropping like all the big new features, the swimming in the ocean. And oh, my God, I can't wait. I know that Danny Trejo can't wait either. Ladies and gentlemen, the comedy stylings of Jordan Vogt Roberts.
How many hipsters does it take to screw in a light bulb?
I don't know, Jordan. How many hipsters does it take to screw in a light bulb?
It's an obscure number. You've probably never heard of it.
I'll take it. Please, no jokes about dairy products, because that's all Adam ever does. I don't know why, but all his jokes are about dairy products. And
not all of my jokes.
Pretty much all of them.
Why don't monkeys play poker in the jungle?
I don't know. Why don't monkeys play poker in the jungle?
Because there are too many cheetahs.
All right. Okay. All right. Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
I was going to go sit in your chair and you sat there.
No one else is allowed to sit in the chair, Jordan. I don't have many rules on this show, but that's one of them.
I was going to get back there.
I'm going to regret this. I know it. Oh, my God. Will you put that away, Adam?
This is my wife in a nutshell right now.
Kiki brought like a whole wardrobe of awesome outfits. I love it. Do you want me giving you a wrapped gift?
Yeah.
Yes,
I would like to invite you to unwrap that now on the show.
I did unwrap it. It says raccoon figurine.
Yes, it's the worst item in the game. It's the ugly ass raccoon that's sitting at the back of the set there next to the jukebox. You now own that. Please take it with the compliments of the show.
I love it.
You gave it to me earlier and told me not to do anything with it, and then I opened it by accident. So then I had to wait till I could put wrapping paper again and then wrap it up like I'd never opened it.
You and Elijah Wood, you just can't resist unwrapping gifts. ahead of time. Do you have your party poppers?
Do you have your party poppers? This was a British thing.
Yes. Do you have your party poppers?
Excuse me, sir. May I borrow a party popper?
Now, before we blow those off, we also have all new closing credits, a new end credits theme composed by Kenny Fong and performed by Kenny Fong and his band, the same guy who did our opening title theme next Wednesday night, July 8th. Simu Liu, Shannon Woodward, and musical guest Sean Wasabi.
Give your party poppers.
Yes, your party poppers. To all my guests, to Shaggy, Jimmy O Yang, Jordan Vote Roberts, and of course Kiki Wolfkill, and everyone who helps make the show possible. Adam Nickerson, my wonderful wife and executive producer Leah Witter, stage manager Kate Stark, all of our moderators. We love our mods. Please get some mod love emotes in the chat. I'm going to invite you all to spin around as the credits are playing. We'll see you all here again next week. But for right now, for me and everyone at Animal Talking, thank you and good night.
I just want to say, you found in real life with party poppers. Amazing. Basically like flashlight tag or like capital flag, but it's amazing with a party pop.